you followed me on Instagram and I clicked the follow button back because we had played against each other so much. And I had a screenshot sent into a WhatsApp group of a few players that I can't name. And there was about three or four of them. And literally they were like, what the fuck is this? You're following this clown on. This, you know, it was in the middle.
It was clown, the monster glass.
Yeah, probably.
I'm sure
not,
it began with a C, but it definitely wasn't clown. It runs a lot deeper in the Scottish blood, does it? The old England fixture. You know what I mean? With this accent going out there against the English as well. It's always
nice to beat England.
Stick it right up them.
It
means a lot. It means a lot in Scotland. And God, I've been here 11 years now, and I've grown to hate the English as well.
I can't believe you watched Braveheart before the game. That is outrageous.
You can picture all the Scots on the team.
Oh my God.
Kilts and swords a lot.
Oh, jeez. That is hilarious.
Hello and welcome to episode number 6 of Rugby Pass Offload with me, Christina Mahan, and today I'm joined by Ryan Wilson, Simon Zebo and Jamie Roberts. We're brought to you this week by Amazon Prime Video. You can catch all 14 of the brand new Autumn Nations Cup internationals exclusively on Amazon Prime Video, where our very own Dylan Hartley and Jamie Roberts will also be on comps. Just visit primevideo.com and start your free trial today. Welcome guys, how are you doing?
I'll start with me, I'm bashed up. Won't talk about the game last night. I'm sore, got back at 3 in the morning this morning, charter flight back, so it wasn't too bad, but yeah, pretty sore this morning.
That's a good result for Glasgow, no?
I was there
a few weeks ago, pal. We lost by 40 to Ulster away a few weeks ago, Jesus. Yeah. They're a good side at home, man, they're a good side.
Yeah, I know. No, we had a pretty young, inexperienced squad out, but no excuses there. Zeebs, you all good, mate?
Good, brother. Good. Yeah, just finished our training there now. First tough session of the week. And we've breathed away this weekend. So hopefully in the mix for that and all well other than that.
So that's a myth then. You boys don't start at like 9 and finish at 11.
No. I was out there at 3 o'clock. I was out of there at 3 o'clock. Yeah. And that was a long day. That was a long day normally. So tomorrow off and... Yeah, I think they've changed. The foreign influences helped that a little bit. Like there was a few days our first year where I was with French lessons and things like that. I was out at 7 or 7:30 every day. So thankfully it's changed a little bit since then.
I mean, those are the days like playing in Brieve. I remember playing there with Racing and like they are proper up for it when you play them down in Brieve. I think we played on a Friday night. It was pissing down with rain and they come at you. Have you played there before, Zeebs?
Yeah, I have just the once. They're a pretty physical bunch. Their squad now this year, they've some big French lads and they have a lot of Fijians and Samoans in their team as well. So they're just all about the confrontation and the physical battle. But
there's nothing else to do in Brieve as well. It's a proper rugby town, isn't it? Like
1 year I was injured. First year I was injured when we went there. And it was a Friday night. The game was on the Saturday. And we were part of the 24, 25th kind of brigade. And we went out on the Friday night and there wasn't a sinner to be seen on the main street of Brieve. Like all the bars, restaurants closed at like 9 or 10. The only show in town was the rugby match the next day. You're spot on there. Yeah, it was mad. I'd never seen anything like it.
Well, lads, I am sure your lives are better than mine at the minute. I am locked away in my house for 14 days. Unfortunately, COVID has struck the Dragons. Got quite a few positive tests, so they've isolated all players, staff and admin staff, which is great fun.
Thanks to you, Jamie. We have an in-house game this week.
You're playing bone on bone amongst the squad here.
How lucky are we? Yeah, cheers, mate. Really, really kind of you. You know what those games are like as well. No one enjoys them.
Lucky you don't have to come up against the mighty Dragons, mate.
Oh, I don't know. That was the one game we were looking forward to over the last 6 games. I think we get someone out of that, but fuck. Yeah, pretty annoying, mate.
Oh, has it for you guys? Has it literally? Do you just kind of go from training to your homes? Like, are you allowed to socialise at all, or is it really, really strict?
No, for us, it's so strict. It's like not allowed to go to coffee shops. Pretty much straight home. No socialising with the boys. Outside the club, you know, I think it's madness, really. You know, you think we do all these tests and we're almost a bubble. I can't see why we don't get to spend more time with each other. Like we've not been able to do any socials and stuff like that, which is so important. Oh, it's killing me. It's driving me mad. There's a whole point you play rugby is to do all that stuff off the field. First time we managed to have beers was on the way back from Belfast. Just because we knew
celebrating a loss.
We knew the game against you boys had been cancelled. So
fantastic result. Right,
let's get a few beers in us.
A virtual celebration for the following week's virtual win against the Dragons. Like, play the game in your minds. Like, no, we're just told to be sensible, Christina. We're kind of, you know, everyone goes about their lives. Wales has just come out of lockdown actually yesterday. And lads, you know, lads probably go to coffee shops and do whatever, but again, obey the rules, minimise the risk.
What's the deal with your boys? You must have known some of the boys like in the Wales camp, the Ireland camp. I mean, with Scotland, Finnell have told you, Zeebs, those boys have gone in for like a 4-week lockdown inside a hotel and they're not allowed out. Is it the same with Wales and Ireland or?
No, I think Wales do a Monday night and a Wednesday night and they have to stay there. I'm pretty sure their day off, they can go home and stuff like that, but certainly when they travel, like they'll travel to Ireland this week, you know, land straight to hotel. They won't be allowed at the hotel and won't be allowed to use the communal spaces in the hotel. Literally just be one team room, have their own rooms, like you're not sharing with lads.
I mean, there's going on tour and spending 4 weeks away and being able to go out in coffee shops and being away from your families, but there's being stuck in a hotel at Heriot Watt University. There's only so much you can do in the hotel. I mean, I reckon the boys are going to go stir crazy, but like an edition of Big Brother, eh? You imagine Finn stuck in the hotel, Zeebs, for four weeks, not being able to get outside.
I'm sure he'd find a way to sneak out somehow, definitely, that fella. It's too hard, though, yeah. I doubt the boys would be, you know, as excited as normal to go away to Irish camps or national camps, sorry. Like, I think the other day, the Irish team, you know, a few of them went out for a bit of golf or something, like, and that was the highlight of the couple of weeks they had, you know. And I was like, that sounds great, you know. But yeah, it's just shit, isn't it, until we get some sort of normality back. Rugby's not the same as what it used to be.
This is a thing. We're an entertainment business. We're here to entertain the crowd, like, you know, like it or loathe it. Without crowd, it's just not the same.
No. We've got the vaccine now, though, so we'll be all right.
Well, yeah.
Thanks for that, Jamie.
Yeah.
hard,
right, so guys, before we get into rugby, Ryan and Zeebo, we need to get to the bottom of something. So you're going to have to talk to me about Munster players, Instagram, and Ryan Wilson stirring shit.
Did you hear about this, Ryan?
Oh, yeah, I did.
Finn was the one that told me about it. That let me know. Go on, give me your side of it, because it came from Finn's mouth, so he'll probably have spun it a little bit, but I was shocked, man.
Yeah.
I wasn't.
I was peer pressured into this, and I just wanted to get that off my chest. It was just a couple of years back, we used to have a lot of games against Glasgow. You know, like whether it was Champions Cup or back-to-backs or playing each other in the league and that, and all the games used to be quite, you know, spicy. Like there should always be a bit of argy-bargy, and you'd be leading that a lot for the Glasgow boys. So there was a few players on the Munster team who wouldn't have been fans of you, you know. And it was just a bit of crack. They weren't too serious, I don't think. But there was one day you followed me on Instagram, and I clicked the follow button back because we had played against each other so much. And I had a screenshot set into a WhatsApp group of a few players that I can't name. And there was about three or four of them. And literally, they were like, what the fuck is this? You're following this clown on this. You know, it was in the middle.
It was clown, the word that was used.
The monster glass. Yeah, probably.
I'm sure
not,
it began with a C, but it definitely wasn't clown. My favourite Irish word.
Oh man. So yeah, I got a bit of heat for that, and then I had to obviously immediately unfollow you.
And then they unfollowed me. Can you believe
that? I did, but I followed you again recently, so don't worry. But yeah, I got so much heat for that. It was just a bit of crack. But I won't name the players, but yeah, it was in the middle of all the games we were playing against each other. Like we gave you hidings every time, but there was still a bit of angst there towards you. So yeah,
no, mate, I cannot believe you unfollowed me.
It was peer pressure. And I didn't want to do it. I think you're a lovely fellow, but
was there a gentleman called Peter involved in that?
Potentially. And there was a few others who I won't
That's
mention.
Amazing. But do you know what? That cements it. That means I've done my job. I know I've done my job when that sort of stuff comes back to me. It's like, well, I'm almost good.
Pat on the back. Pat on the back. You've done your job. Well played.
Ryan, who's your favourite?
Someone, Conway, maybe?
Conway was in... You know it. That's the fellas you were stirring up. You know too well. Yeah.
Do you just want to name who you think was in the group, Ryan? Who do you think was in that group that gave out to
you? It was Peter Armani and definitely Conway. That was the two definites, the bolters. And I'm guessing Conor Murray's in there as well.
Yeah.
Because there was that whole thing about us targeting Conor Murray and targeting him when he was kicking the ball from the base of rucks, which we were.
Yeah, going after his standing leg, you dirty showers. You know all about it. Yeah. Oh, we hated you. Oh, there was real rivalry there for a few
seasons. I love it, though. I absolutely love it. And we've got a game against Munster, well, in 2 weeks. That's our next game now. So, but with this young squad, I'm going to have to get them up to speed on what it means, you know, what it means to some of us Glasgow boys.
Listen, man, we play Brieve this week. And obviously, we don't have fans coming to the game. So, money is a little bit down. So, we're not flying anymore. We're getting the bus down. So, that's 6 hours down. And the game starts at 6.
You know, I'm Lorenzetti's private jet.
Not for the next 2 weeks. Okay. But that'll be back for Europe, I hope. But then the following week, we play La Rochelle away. And the game starts at 9:30 or 9:45. And we get the bus back and we arrive at 6 in the morning into Paris.
Jesus.
Yeah.
But see those bus trips. How good. I'm not joking. My favourite ones are the mega bus back from Wales. Have you done any of them before?
No.
From Glasgow, we have the mega bus. So when we play down in Wales, it's a sleeper bus. And we get on the bus after we've played it like a 7 o'clock game. And you get on the bus about 9:30. Pizzas, beers, whatever. We've had a big Nando's takeout. And the boys just sit and have a few beers and go back overnight.
Around the sorrows after losing.
You're the Dragons, Jamie. Every you're talking week. A good game for Dragons, son. Honestly, the way you're talking, you're not in these big French clubs anymore.
I was on about test matches, mate.
You're back down at Rodney Parade, where Cody is the least of anyone's worries with those fans.
Oh, my God.
Oh, dear. Well, guys, look, there's no Dylan this week. So ahead of the Autumn Nations, we can finally have an honest conversation on what the home nations actually think about England. So how much does it matter to beat England?
Oh, God, it matters a lot. Do you know what? I've never seen so many grown men cry when I've left Twickenham and we beat England in the World Cup in 2015. Played against England loads, probably lost as many as I've won. Won at Twickenham a few times, won in Cardiff a few times and lost at both probably the same amount of times. But when we beat England in the World Cup at Twickenham, I kid you not, I saw probably 30 or 40 grown men in absolute tears as we got back on the bus. It means that much to people, especially, you know, those passionate fans and stuff. Unfortunately, we couldn't celebrate that result because we had to get straight back and we had a 4-day turnaround to play Fiji. It means the world to not just the players, but the fans more importantly. You know, you kind of know when you play England that every community hall, every rugby club, every, you know, pub in deepest, darkest North Wales, West Wales, they've all got the game on and they're absolutely rammed with fans watching it. And you kind of understand what it means to play England, you know, just the history of the fixture, you know?
Yeah, very much the same anyway in Ireland. It just means a lot. You notice how much it means, as you said, when you see the fans, the passion and the atmosphere is just, it's unreal. Yeah, and we didn't have a memory like that, beating them at their home World Cup, you know, knocking them out, that must have been pretty special. But I think everybody in the world had Welsh jerseys on that day, which was great to see. But yeah, it means a lot. Yeah, definitely means a lot to beat them. They're obviously an incredible team, but it's nice to humble them, you know, and because they can be an arrogant bunch at times. But it's always nice to beat England.
Oh, it's the arrogance, isn't it? It's the arrogance they've
it
got.
It is, for sure.
Ryan, have you ever beaten England?
Yeah, once.
Under 16s or something?
I was actually the first person to get a win on English soil as captain.
Go away.
With Scotland Day. down at Newcastle, shaved my mow. God, I was probably about 23, and God knows why. He was like, "Well, so you're going to captain," and it was the first time I'd ever done any sort of captaincy. I was like, "Oh shit, what's he done here?" And we actually went down. It was down at Newcastle, and it was one of the worst games of rugby ever, the worst weather, but we scraped through it and beat them. And yeah, that was another good night out in Newcastle after that one. But yeah, Calcutta Cup. What was that? 2-3 years ago now, when we beat them at Murrayfield with the whole tunnel gate stuff that happened.
Yeah.
It runs a lot deeper in the Scottish blood, does it? The old England fixture. You know what I mean? With this accent going out there against the English as well. It's always
always nice to beat England.
Stick it right up them. It means a lot. It means a lot in Scotland. And God, I've been here 11 years now, and I've grown to hate the English as well. We actually put Braveheart on the night before we beat them at Calcutta Cup. Like, you know, people joke about it. We actually stuck it on, and like, to get yourselves up. It's hilarious. But yeah, that was a good win at the Calcutta Cup. And then obviously the game down at Twickenham to then come back. You know, that one where they ran away, and then half time you hear about Finn and Tooney having a crack in the changing room, Finn telling him, "Nah, we're not going to kick it anymore. We're just going to run it," which is, people ask, is that true? But you'll know, Zeebs, that's exactly the way Finn will go. He's like, "Nah, listen, we ain't giving them the ball back." And they clawed it back to get that draw, and probably should have won that one again as well. So
I remember watching that game. That was one of the best games of rugby I've ever seen.
Class.
It was ridiculous. It was ridiculous. I remember that game, I was actually injured. And after Tunnelgate, after everything that happened in the tunnel against England, I'd lined up a corporate gig down at Twickenham, and it all lined up. You know what it's like, a little bit of cash, all excited.
Famous grouse?
I don't know what it was, to be honest. But it was old Clive at our agency had lined it up, only to get a message back saying that the RFU have banned you from Twickenham Stadium. You're after joking. Everything that happened the year before. So made me even more eager to get down there and try and sneak into the stadium, and still managed to get in there and get a couple gigs. But yeah, no, genuinely, the RFU said, "Listen, we don't want him on the premises after some of the things that were said and done in the tunnel at Murrayfield," which is madness, isn't it, to think that they would do that. But again, another little win on my sheet, just to know that I pissed them off that much.
Good boy, you've got a big old sheet, I'd say.
I know, it's not really a wise way to go about living your life.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know.
Ryan, I'm going to have to go back here. So can you just talk us through what actually happened in that tunnel? I feel like you were priming us for that, but yeah, please elaborate.
I wasn't priming anyone. It's just literally, listen, I think that the psychological game is massive in rugby. Like, you know, when we talk about Conor Murray's oops and... Just the small things, like when he's at the back of a ruck and you're talking him up, "I'm coming for you," or little things in his ear is after he's kicked the ball saying, "Right, next one, I've got you," or "I'm going for your leg." Just, it does, it checks you. In your mind, you're like, "Oh, here we go." And especially for nine, starting to worry about things like that, a little bit of pressure. Mm. And probably with England is they go over expecting to win. And yeah, it was just more coming down the tunnel. I was probably looking for Farrell more than anyone. My old mate Owen Farrell, and I couldn't find him as we were coming down the tunnel. So it's just a word in George Ford's ear, just to say, I won't tell you exactly what I said, but it was more just, you know, "We're coming for you. You want to watch yourself." Might have spoke about breaking some bones somewhere.
Did he swing for you then?
And mate, he would have floored me. So thank God not. But no, it was Owen Farrell that spotted it, because he obviously knew what I was up to as soon as he saw me talking to him. As we were walking in after the warm-up, and Owen came steaming down behind, and he shoved me in the back, and that was it. It just sort of rolled down into the tunnel. But, you know, and then the boys get a bit of a buzz, and us as a Scotland team, you get under their skin, and you can see it. You can, because people don't really do it. People go out, and a lot of Scotland teams have gone out against England and think, "Fuck, we've not got a massive chance here." And so no one really, I don't think anyone really goes at them before a game, because it's ballsy. I'm not talking myself up too much, but you give a lot of shit to another team and then you get pumped. You look like a bit of an idiot, don't you, afterwards? Mm. Whereas that one paid off, because we got in the changing room afterwards and Greed tried to sort of calm us down. And I remember he was trying to calm us down, the boys going to the toilet, and then we come to the huddle and it was like, nah, fuck that, boys. Here we go. Let's get into them. And that was it. We went out and played so well. Finn stole the show, obviously, and Hugh Jones had a stormer. But, yeah, that was one performance I always remember at Murrayfield against the English.
Class story, mate. What was your tactic this weekend against Ulster, then?
just to keep the boys going.
Keep it under 50.
Did you give any jib to the Ulster team?
Did I, fuck? Not until right at the end, you know.
Oh, the end, okay.
Not until right at the end, you know. When one of the boys, Johnny Matthews, first game for the he's probably his third game for the club, young guy, and he's tried to do one of these tap and goes, and he's knocked the ball on.
Oh shit!
We're 15 down. We're on their line. You know what I mean? We're out, and they've come in and given the old tap on the head to him, and that pisses me off because, like, all right,
that's the sort of thing you do.
No, but not 40, yes, 15 up. Correct. Not 40, 15 up, man.
All right.
Like, when the game's close, but once it's done, then you're like, right, it's done now. But the reason I do it is to try and, you know, wind people up in the game and have that edge. But when it's that far gone, come on. Like, I can't remember who it was, but that was the only little bit of niggle there. But I was looking forward to the Dragons game. You were getting it.
After we beat it.
Right, guys, so we're going to move on to the Autumn Nations Cup, which starts on Friday with Ireland versus Wales. Jamie, do you back Wales to avoid a sixth defeat in a row?
Do you know what? I think we're going to see a reaction from Wales this Friday night. I don't think many people will back him. I think the players will be hurting. There's been, you know, obviously, obvious change this week in the Welsh coaching setup. And I think the players, you know, will be desperate to go and put a performance into the jersey. They were poor against Scotland. We'll come to that in a minute, Ryan, before you blow your own trumpet. But yeah, Wales are poor, and I think we'll see a reaction. Do I think they can beat Ireland and Dublin? Yes, they've got to be at the top of their game, but I think we'll see a big reaction from the Welsh.
So, what do you reckon Ireland are going to do, aren't they, this weekend?
I'd say so, yeah. I'd say Ireland are probably performing a little bit better, although they weren't great against France. I think the improvements Ireland need to make wouldn't be as great as the Welsh. I don't think they're playing very well, yeah. They seem to be quite lateral. They don't seem to be, you know, playing with the physicality and defences they used to under Sean Edwards. It just doesn't seem like the typical Welsh team. There's no fear, I'd imagine, of playing them like there would have been in the past. And you see their recent results, you know, the form and confidence is probably a little bit down, but I'd be the same as Jamie. I'd expect them to put in a big performance. You know, playing in Dublin with no fans will be an unbelievable opportunity for them to get back on the winning side. So,
I'm amazed James Lowe is only getting his first cap now this weekend. Top player. Like,
I think that's because he's only Ireland qualified, only eligible, now, isn't he?
Yeah,
oh,
yeah,
really?
Yeah.
That was going to be my question. As Eves is honestly, what? How does it make you feel seeing him play for Ireland, and you're sat there, an Irish man, albeit in France, but watching a man that's qualified on residency go and play for Ireland in your position, a gobshite as well.
Hey! Oh, take that back. Oh,
mouthy as they come.
Honestly. Oh, coming from you.
Honestly,
hot calling the kettle.
Exactly. Just honestly, taste your own medicine.
What's your, like, honestly, mate? What's your gut feeling there? Like, when you saw it, were you a bit?
No, to be fair, I don't, like, I've no issue with that. You know, I've, like, more power to him. Like, go out and do your thing. He's been an integral part of Leinster the last couple of years. He's been banging in tries, and, you know, he deserves it 100%. So I hope he goes up and has a great debut. Obviously, I would love to be involved, and that would probably never change. But, you know, not being eligible would annoy me more than, you know, someone like James or Bundy, of course, you know, just because I play abroad. And we saw when Johnny was playing abroad, you know, people say, oh, we're protecting Irish rugby. But how many players left when Johnny left? You know, there wasn't a big exodus. There hasn't been a big exodus since I've left. You know, I think that's a bit of a myth. It was the same when Tommy Bow left to play for the Ospreys, you know. So I can understand them.
Because they look after you tax-wise, Simon.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
But,
people know that.
Yeah, true. But yeah, it's probably the annoying thing would be probably that I'm ineligible, you know. But definitely not any angst towards James or Bundy or these guys. You know, they give it 100% every time they play for either Leinster or Ireland, and power to them. But You know, you wouldn't, I would, you hear stories of, you know, coaches in the past going out saying like, oh, come play in Ireland, you'll play for Ireland, you know, like kind of, I think there probably has to be a bit more value put on the Irish jersey or what it means to Irish people to play for their country. I think at times the business side of rugby can take over a bit more when it comes to wanting to win games, you know, so there's a few things that I wouldn't agree with, but for people like James and Bundy and these guys and CJ, more power to them. They're great players and they only add to the team. So, yeah.
But did you catch any of the clips of Johnny explaining his reaction to coming off during the French game?
I knew that was, you know, Johnny, to be fair, obviously wouldn't have done that, as he said, if there was, if he knew he was on the big screen, but he's so passionate. He cares so much, you know, and he
was
more
he shaking his head at the coach.
Yeah.
mate, what are you doing?
Oh, that's hilarious. I can understand. And now, to be fair to him, as I just said, he was World Player of the Year like 2 years ago, not even. So, you know, if anyone, being the captain too, if anyone was going to make a swing in that game and change the game, it was only 8 points with 10 minutes left or whatever. He was obviously very, very disappointed, you know, and it's just unfortunate for him that he came up on the big screen at that time and people made a big deal out of it. But that's Johnny, he's the competitor he is. He wants to be on the field all the time. So I can understand why he was upset. But
I love the way he kept just asking the reporter, how would you want me to react? How do you want me to react?
That's him. Like, you know, his mentality is the same as someone like Jordan, you know, like that's like, I'm not saying he's as good as Michael Jordan at all, but that's the same mentality. That's the same competitor. You know, anytime I've dealt with him, you see it all the time, even on the pitch when he plays, he's so intense and he just cares so much. Incredibly passionate guy. And he wants to win more than anything. And you saw when he came off the pitch, Ireland didn't get better. You know, the Byrne, I think, came on, had a couple of mistakes and, you know, the game was pretty much over. So I feel for him and I don't think he deserved the little bit of backlash he got. But yeah, he's a classy player and a classy guy. So
Ryan, is he someone you'd love to wind up on the pitch?
We've had some run-ins again. We've had some run-ins.
But, who haven't you had run-ins with? Probably me, actually. I don't think we've had any run-ins.
No, we haven't.
No.
No, because we're good blokes. We know what the crack is off the field, where some of these guys take it too seriously. Peter Armani, honestly, I think has genuine hatred for me.
Oh, you
know. I've been at the bottom of a ruck, and it's been the old thumb in the throat at the bottom of a ruck, and I've gone back for him, and it's almost like first one to pass out.
Yeah.
Each other. Just looking at each other like, you're going first.
Oh, brilliant. Oh,
But you know, the problem, I've never managed to actually catch up and have a beer with him after the game. Like a lot of the boys I get to. But for some reason, I feel like if I sort of made the inroad to the Ireland dressing room, I would get battered when I got in there.
Oh, I would love to see you knock on the door and walk in. It would be on. As soon as you poke your head in, there would be fists swinging. I promise. I'd love to see it. Do it next time you play, man.
Yeah, against
for Glasgow. For Glasgow.
There we go. Right, so guys, England versus Georgia. There's talk of Eddie Jones playing 9 forwards. So he wants to develop a hybrid of forwards and backs players. Do you think this is a good idea?
I've been a hybrid forward back for my whole career, I think.
So you see it,
I'm literally a glorified second row.
You're bigger than me.
Yeah, that's not.
What do you weigh? What do you weigh, John?
It's not hard, mate.
Oh, I know. I've got plenty of heart, though. What do you weigh, mate? Honestly, what are you, 110?
110, I am, yeah.
Fat bastard.
Yeah. It's fascinating.
Nah, to be honest, 20 kilos is probably your head, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
Who's going to say 105 from the neck up?
Exactly. No, I think it's fascinating. You know, Eddie's always been a bit of an innovator as a coach, isn't he?
Where would you go, Zeebs, if you could be another position? Oh, 10, obviously.
10, straight into 10. Oh.
the ball
wouldn't see the outside backs wouldn't see the ball. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I'd love a crack. Yeah, chip and chase, offload. Oh, it would be fun. Yeah, I'd love to try it.
I've played at 12 before against Edinburgh when we ran out of players, basically.
Oh, yeah.
And they were like, right, getting at 12. I absolutely loved it. I genuinely like to
play again. Did you thrive?
I thrived, yeah. Just the big bang up big bang up 12 while the normal sized
no scrums.
Yeah, no, it was pretty cool. And also, when I came back from injury, we have to play for a club team in Scotland. So back in the day, Sean and Ian used to, when you were coming back from like a long-term injury, try and get you a bit of game time at one of these clubs like Ayr. And I went down to Ayr, and the coach, before the game, someone was injured. And he said to the boys, right, who's going to play 12? And I said, oh, yeah, I play 12. And he'd sent me down there to obviously play in the back row, and I lied and told him that I played 12. And he actually put me in at 12. And when Sean and Ian saw the video back, he was raging. Screaming at me, and I played a whole game at 12 for Ayr, and I loved it. Honestly, I couldn't have got enough of it.
The dream. Mate, I love the thought of playing like back row would be awesome. I just dread the idea of being in driving malls and people standing on my feet like with studs on. That's my biggest fear of playing six. I don't mind the collisions, don't mind the like or any of the contact stuff. Being in malls and having props stand on my toes is my biggest.
Yeah, no, it's not fun. It is not fun.
Don't need that in my life.
Mm-hmm. Well, remember, guys, that you can catch all the Autumn Nations action on Amazon Prime. Just visit primevideo.com to sign up. So, Zeebo, we'll move on to your section now. What has caught your eye on social media this week?
Actually, I reposted something that LeBron put up as you were talking earlier about the presidential race in America. LeBron put up a funny photo of one of his famous blocks in the NBA Finals where it was Joe Biden blocking Donald Trump, and I love that. That probably caught my eye. I got a good giggle off of that.
So you're safe to say you're, well, like most people, you're delighted to see the back of Trump.
Yeah, for sure. He annoys me. He's just, you just hate to see people, you know, with that level of, you know, ignorance and, you know, a complete racist, like he is a sexist, all these things that tick the boxes that towards things that I hate. You just hate to see people like him in power or with that much power. And, you know, since he was in charge, you have a lot of people who traditionally would have been probably closet racists and things like that, afraid, who've just grown a pair now, and all of a sudden it's cool to be racist in places like America, obviously, but globally, I think it's come out a bit. So it's nice to see him get fired and hopefully a better man for the job in.
He's still trying to cling in though, isn't he?
He is, yeah. He's not going out without a fight, but
unbelievable, isn't it?
Can you imagine someone like that in rugby circles? I'm trying to come up with an example, some sort of similar example in rugby. I probably can't, but like, I think for a sport, for us sports people who kind of pride ourselves on the values of the game and whatever, the guy is unbelievable.
Yeah, he's ridiculous. He is. But do you know what? At least, you know, he's not, he doesn't shy away from it. You know, he is all the things I've just said, but at least you know he is, you know, he's not one of these fakes. There's plenty of those politicians who pretend to be one thing and, you know, they are another, so. He can actually be quite funny with how outrageous he is on Twitter and things like that. But yeah, it's good to see the back of him.
Yeah, I think there's talk. I think I read an article about how Twitter, I think, have the power to now delete him or block him off social media once he steps down as president, because like the stuff he just says is so ludicrous. But I think presidents get special treatment or whatever. So it'd be nice to see the day that he gets blocked or deleted off Twitter.
Sure. It is brilliant that someone held back that vaccine news right until after the elections there, just to make sure he couldn't use that.
Isn't it? Oh, mental. Just
a bit on that.
It's good.
Biden found that.
Zeebo, it's been a few weeks now since the Heineken Champions Cup final. How has the Racing squad been getting over the defeat?
Yeah, we got over it a little bit. You know, it still obviously hurts when we, you know, talk back about it or think back to it, but yeah, we've had a couple of games since and we've gone quite well. Now, obviously, we're missing a good few of our squad through the international window. So hopefully when those guys come back as well, we'll just push on into next season. But definitely it hurts a lot. You know, I think if you take out that 20 minutes, the first 15 or 20 minutes of that game, we win quite easy, you know, or not quite easy. But I think we'd be a bit more comfortable.
I felt for you lads down in Bristol. I was working, I was doing some TV work down there, and literally I wanted to come on and give you lads a hug after. I felt for you boys. But there's one lad, like Wenceslas Loray, right? Top boy. He's lost 4 Champions Cup finals.
Mad, isn't it?
He's lost 3 with Racing. He lost 1 with Toulouse, am I right?
Biarritz.
Sorry, Biarritz. 2010,
yeah.
near it since 2010. So he's gone 10, 16, 18, 20. And he's lost four finals. Like, I felt for the bloke. This was his time. He's going to have to wait another year to give it a shot. How is he holding up?
He's been good, yeah. Oh, he hit him very, very hard. You know, as you were saying, four Champions Cup final losses is insane. He's been in good form. He's been in good form of late. I suppose it kind of helps a little bit, you know, that, you know, nobody wants to lose a Champions Cup final, but the difference of being able to have your family there and supporters there and friends there would have been that extra bit special. So we were kind of joking the week after. We're like, all right, we'll let them have this one and we'll get the one now with the crowds back next year. So exactly. Fingers crossed.
Love that photo of Finn and Hoggy after the game. You know, they're sat having a beer. But what no one sees was Johnny Gray was so pissed off because he sat just at a shot with a beer as well with him. And he's completely been cut out the picture and forgotten about it. He was raging about that. So I wanted to get that in there for him. He was in there as well in a beer with the boys.
He didn't make the shot, though. He didn't make the fame.
Oh, God bless him. But hey, that was a dangerous one for Finn going back into camp, having a couple of beers with Hoggy, eh?
Yeah, yeah, wasn't he the ringleader that got Finn booted out in the first place? I fair play to them. I'm glad Finn and Gregor and probably Captain Hoggy as well, you know, that they had their kiss and make up. It's so much better for the Scottish team. Like, jokes aside, they're nowhere near the side they are when Finn is playing, you know, the drop off from when he plays and someone else in his position. From the outside looking in anyway, seems massive. So it's only good for Scottish rugby that they've made up. And hopefully they go well now. Finn goes well.
Finn's injured, isn't he?
Yeah, he's injured for a couple of weeks. But
Is he back over with you boys at the moment?
Yeah, he's back rehabbing with us and he should be good to go, hopefully, for a Champions Cup in the second.
Back in the champagne and fags for a bit.
Not at all. Uber Eats, yeah, for sure.
Every time I look at the screen, I just see Ryan about to just start giggling. And I just genuinely don't know what you're about to say next.
It's because I'm just getting ribbed left, right, and centre. The wind's cracked, losing for Glasgow, losing for Scotland.
Sorry. I can't believe he watched Braveheart before the game. That is outrageous.
You can picture all the Scots now in the team room.
Oh, my God.
Kilts and swords a lot.
Oh, jeez. That is hilarious. That's so funny.
Johan Huget of Toulouse announced that this season will be his last. Has anyone had any run-ins with him down the years? I'm going to look at you first, Ryan.
Nope. You've never given him some drip. You must have, mate.
I don't know if I've played against him.
No. I've crossed paths with him loads of times against Toulouse and with France. Great player, strong player, quick player. So wishing the best in his last season. As for run-ins, nah, no real confrontations. I remember seeing a clip of him actually, like, standing on someone's face. And I remember thinking, I think it was an accident. I don't think he ever got a ban for it.
Sounds like Dylan would say.
He's a fiery character, to be fair to him.
He is fiery. He is fiery. But he's a top player.
Mm-hmm. Legend. Unbelievable player. We had a good few games against him, actually, when I was with Munster. And there was actually a small story, not a big story, but he as I was saying, he's quite a fiery character. And I'm 90% sure it was Conor Murray now that this happened to. I'll have to find out, so don't call me out on it if I'm wrong. But during the game, at a couple of rucks, Huget like was going and stamping on Conor's foot, you know, and Conor caught him. He's like, hey, what are you doing, ref? Look what he's doing, you know. Conor was like, oh, fuming. And it kept happening like three or four times during the game. Anyway, the game had finished and we were doing the little tunnel shake in everyone's hand. And Huget went up with a big smile. Like, Conor thought it was genuine, but it was actually a fake smile. He shook Conor's hand and stood on his foot again. And he was like, what's going on? The whistle is blown. Like, and that just summed up to me how much of a lunatic he was. So funny, man. I couldn't stop laughing, but what a hell of a player. But absolute lunatic.
That's brilliant.
Amazing. Yeah, stood in this one again. Very funny.
Ryan, are you taking notes there? Is that something you're going to do in your next game?
Yeah, no, that's a good one, that. That's quite a good one. But it wouldn't be like Conor Murray to moan to the ref. You know, that's unheard of.
So guys, I'm going to move on to some social questions. So I have actually, the first one I have is for all of you. So when looking towards next year, who would you guys have as a bolter, as part of your Lions squad, apart from yourselves? So Jamie, I'll start with you.
Two for me. One, Hamish Watson. I think he's a top, top player and someone who's probably gone under the radar, but I think he's an immense player. And it wouldn't surprise to see a player of his style against the Springboks. And two, John Cooney. I think Cooney will start for Ireland in the Six Nations. I think he's that good. I'm amazed he's not involved. Zeebs, I know you're good mates with Murray. I think Cooney's a top, top player. I just don't see where he's missing out. I think he could end up on the Lions tour.
So, Jamie, are you saying that you think Cooney should get in ahead of Connor?
I don't think he should get in ahead of it. I think he should be in the Ireland squad, and I think he should be fighting for that starting position. I think he's good enough. Obviously, you know, I don't pick the Ireland side. Andy Farrell does, but I think, you know, if I was to pick one player now who probably had long odds for getting on the tour, it'd be him.
All right, Sebo, who do you think?
I probably would go for as a bolter anyway. Do you know who I like actually, Jamie? The young winger for Gloucester, Zammit. That lad.
Lewis Rhys Zammit.
Yeah, I'd say if he gets a few games for Wales under his belt, you never know. You know, he's got serious gas and seems to have a good bit of flair about him, can create something out of nothing. So as a bolter, I'd choose him. Yeah, seems like a decent player.
And Ryan?
You bang on with Hamish Watson, I reckon, Jamie. He honestly, like, playing with him as well, impossible to get off the ball once he's on there. And I don't think there's another player that will break so many first and second tackles. And it's not always going forward, but it will go across the pitch and just start bumping people off. Mm. Just disrupts defences like you wouldn't believe. So it'd be awesome to see him in there. And obviously Finn, I want to see Finn involved heavily somehow. He's got to be involved.
He has to start. The form he's been in is absolutely ridiculous. There's no 10 in world rugby who has the skill set he has. You know, if you go out to play a team like South Africa, playing them with, you know, trying to bludgeon them or play with brute force isn't going to work. He has to start. Like, you know, you have to beat them outside. You have to stretch them, you know, put their defence out under pressure out wide and things like that. There's no, like, England tried to beat them up in the World Cup and look what happened there. Like, so I think if you play, build your team around Finn, that's what I do anyway. I think when he's on, there's literally no player in world rugby who can do what he can do. So there's a difference between going out to win a series or going out not to lose. And I think if you're going out to win it, he's your 10.
It's almost like, yeah, we didn't really miss Dylan at all. We just had another pantomime villain on the show today.
Yeah, we have two of the most hated players in world rugby on our pod.
I'm all right with that. You know, I'm all right off the field.
We're going to need you just to make your peace with Munster. Like, Zeebo, do you think you can be the person that just...
Never. Not until I'm done. I'm going to get a Burger King as well next time I'm over there and see what happens to me.
You're just going to be waiting for a fight or waiting to be tackled?
Yes.
It'll be dangerous for you now.
Right. Okay, well, that's it from us for this week. Thanks to Ryan Wilson, Simon Zeebo and Jamie Roberts. And thanks to you for listening. More offloading next week. Make sure to subscribe to the show wherever you get your podcast so you get them as soon as it's released. Leave us a rating and review if you can. And don't forget to check us out on YouTube as well. Thanks, guys.